Amanda with Straight Smile Solutions, straightsmilesolutions.com, and we're going to revisit the topic of class 3 patients and compromise treatment. And I have a few other videos like this. You can go to my YouTube channel, Straight Smile Solutions, go to the tabs on the top, scroll to the right where the magnifying glass is, and put in keywords like compromise. And it should bring up my other videos on compromise treatment plans. Now, of course, you should always consult your own Dental Practice Act in your own state or country of licensure so that you know the rules. This is just the way I was trained. I tend to be a little conservative on compromise cases. If you've worked with me on cases before, just because I've gotten myself in trouble before. It's all said and done, and it's nice when the patient's like, yeah, I understand. And you write this out and you have them sign some additional informed consents and you think you're all good and they say they understand and then you debond and then something happens, like there's damage or something else, or all those risks we said might happen actually happen. And then all they got to do is go to the dental board or the insurance company and make a complaint. And at best, you are giving a full refund. At worst, you are defending yourself. And it's involving lawyers and additional fees. And it is just so not worth it, in my opinion. I know that 90% of the patients who say they're cool with things are cool with things, but there's always a small percentage that just either really didn't understand it or just are looking at an opportunity to make some quick cash later. And trust me, even I've been so blindsided by this, and I thought I had a good judge of character and I was wrong. So because this has stung me enough times, you can see my voice is literally wavering because it has so hurtful. Because we literally sat down and talked to the patient and went over, here, I really don't want you to do this. I really think you should do this and this instead. No, I get it. I'm willing to sign anything. You think those signatures hold water, and guess what? They don't. So that's why I don't want you to do it. But let's talk a little bit more about class 3 patients, which is significantly worse in terms of liability than class 2 patients. And I have other videos on class 2. Nobody died from a little bit of overjet, but a lot of damage can be done by class 3 and leaving a patient in a class 3 bite where there's actual anterior interferences like this, okay? If the patient started like that and they just want straight teeth, sorry, not gonna do it. That's just my position. Your bite is bad to begin with, but I'm not gonna straighten your teeth and leave your bite bad. I'm sorry, because it's just, I know better than that, you know? If the patient is so class 3, and I don't have an example of this, if they're like more severe class 3 than this, and if I take, and there's no anterior interferences, then okay, I'll do it. You want straight teeth, and just as long as I'm not pushing the teeth through the bone or putting it in a worse situation, I'm just putting it in a straight worse situation and there's no damage risk. It's just, you're just high and dry. They're not even touching. Fine, I'll do it. I've done that before. But I won't do this and I won't do that. I'm not going to leave it like that. We have to fix the bite, whether that means lower sequential distalization, it means jaw surgery, it means lower incisor extraction, or maybe just means some lower IPR, or maybe it means opening up spaces for some veneers on 7 and 10, upper 2s, whatever. Obviously, you're going to need a cephalometric x-ray in order to make that decision. But that is just my position, and I'm pretty firm on that just because, like I said, I've been stung on it enough times. If you think that you're gonna dodge a bullet, I would strongly recommend, before you even do this, contacting your liability insurance company and going over the situation. And they may not know ortho. If you're a GP, you're not using like AAOIC, which is an ortho related one, right? They cover you for ortho, but they don't have ortho people on their team. So I think you have to kind of maybe give them this video and they'll understand it. And then maybe they can help create a special document for you that's a little bit more airtight than the ones I thought I had. No, I did not have lawyers draft my informed consents. I used the standard informed consent, plus I made a supplemental one that I custom made going over the risk, benefits, and alternatives for the patient. Had them sign, I signed. That's how we were trained in residency. It should be safe. Ultimately, if it had gone to trial or something, I'm sure I would have won, but how much money and time and stress are you putting in to even defend yourself? You're talking $10,000, $20,000, $30,000, or your malpractice insurance, they don't want you to do that. So run it by them first, make them help you create a document would be my suggestion. If they are just super last days ago and they're cool with you doing it, that's a red flag to me. So, all right, hopefully that was helpful. Thanks.